Hello and welcome to BusyWorksBeats.com. Today we continue the mixing series right here at BusyWorksBeats.com. And today I want to acknowledge MG The Future, who had an interview with Young Guru, who's an amazing engineer. And man, I'm going to link the video below. You have to watch it. It's a must watch. In like the first 5 to 10 minutes, Young Guru just drops napalm on napalm of fire. It's incredible. And one thing he went over, which is the biggest mistake producers and artists and engineers are making while they're mixing, is that you're not getting your leveling right. Now, it seems simple. You're like, okay, level is this dB. But you have to understand hearing deeper than just dB. Okay, I can't get into everything today, but this is the biggest mistake producers are making. They're making their songs too loud. So, for example, you probably use Omnisphere. So let's open up a random thing in Omnisphere. I'm just going to go to keyboards and shuffle, just so it's super random. Click on a sound. Now, we're not picking on Omnisphere. Let's click on a different sound, because that's out of a... Let me narrow it down to Omnisphere. Let's do this again. Okay, so let's say you find a bell sound. Now, when you play the bell sound, what Young Guru is talking about is you can get loudness without using a bunch of dB. And what I mean by that is, the disconnect is that a lot of producers don't understand the preamp. And he talked about the preamp in the recording process. This is something I learned when I learned from my mentor, Ron DiSilvestro, over in Ford Studios in the Philadelphia area. And he showed us the importance of a preamp. I mean, the whole juice behind the mixing console was its preamp. And I didn't know what a preamp really did because it's not evident in FL Studio. So if you open up FL Studio, you just have a mixer fader. And that's it. You really don't think of these as preamp knobs because it's not really illustrated as a preamp knob. So what I'm trying to say in a long about way is that when you're playing sounds, let's just create a track so that you understand leveling as a whole. Now, this video might go on for a little bit, but you know, the knowledge Young Guru dropped is insane. So again, thank you, Young Guru, and thank MG The Future for making that happen. He always said that he talked to people from the companies and stuff, but I never thought that we'd hear from Young Guru. So that's an awesome video. Okay, so what I'm going to do is create some type of melody, and let's just keep it simple. I'm not here to make a complex song today. It's more so to show you about leveling. So let me just keep it very basic. A minor and let's jazz it up at the end. Let's make the bass note F, so it plays F major 7. You don't even have to know what I'm doing here. This is arbitrary. But I'm doing this so I could set up the Omnisphere. So, Young Guru talks about VU meters. VU meter was a different way of measuring sound. That's the easiest way to put it. In your DAW, it measures sound a little bit differently. So, 0 here is different than the 0 on your VU meter. Okay, so he mentions negative 18 values and negative 20 values. I have to do a little more research as to which plugin he's talking about or which company he's talking about. But I measured one time and I got negative 12 as far as actually negative 12 would be a measuring tool for loudness. That's a different conversation between the K meters and all these different things when it comes to mastering. But he mentions LUFS and all this type of stuff. So I don't want to confuse you with mastering talk. Let's just talk about leveling. I already went way beyond the scope of the video, but long story short, you're recording your sounds way too loudly, okay, in dB. So this sound is going up to negative 7 dB. That's already like screaming as far as the VU meter would go. Okay, so again, there's a disconnect because we don't have these metering systems, so we're doing things a lot differently today. So what you want to do in general is turn down your channel volume or the volume from your plugin. I wouldn't really mess with the fader unless you have to. The only reason I use the fader is to pull stuff down, okay? I don't really use the fader to pull stuff up. I use it to pull stuff down. So what I'm going to do, since we have a volume control here, let's use this before we use the fader. So loudness is very particular because loudness, the way your ear is set up, in short. Now, we have mixing courses at BusyWorksBeats.com that go into depth about this, and I studied biology as a biology major. And one thing we did go over is how the ear works. So the ear works in a very fascinating way. So for example, we don't hear sub frequencies very easily. We have to have them boosted. That's why people love bass. It's because we naturally don't pick up on those bass frequencies as an audible thing. We pick up frequencies from about 2K to 5K very strongly. So if you're boosting, so for example, I can turn this bell down, but it's still loud, so to speak. We can still hear the notes. That's because certain frequencies sound louder. Even though the dB is lower, they still sound loud. So dB is not a direct reflection to loudness, okay? And he was going in about dynamic range and all these things. So when you turn your sounds down, this offers more depth, more contrast in volume and leveling. And that's what creates more dynamic range. Dynamic means change. Range would be the difference between two points. So there's a volume difference. Okay, so one thing you want to get in the habit of doing is just start turning your plugins down. There's ways to get this loud without it going above a certain dB level. That's because intensity is loudness. Okay, so don't confuse dB with intensity. Intensity is taking a kick. Like, for example, if you go to busyworksbeats.com, grab a kick. Let me pull up kick punch. This one's good. It sits over top of 808s very well. So let me plug in our melody and the chord. Actually, it's a chord progression more so. Let's plug this in. Okay, let's go to pattern two. Let's begin our kick pattern. Now for this kick, a lot of people are like, oh, this kick is flimsy, it's weak. He even mentioned that he will ask people for the original 808 because he can make the 808 sound a lot better than people who just crank the 808 up to 1000 dB and try to slam it to death. It's because you have to understand the power of a preamp. So let's show you the power of a preamp and how it can make a sound completely different. So what a preamp does, you know, I know I'm going into a lot of different avenues, but hopefully this wisdom will help you understand why we do stuff. And when you understand why you do stuff, you'll understand how to be better at it. And that's why I respect Young Guru, because he's a great teacher and he's not holding stuff back. You know, he's an excellent teacher. Same with MG. So I respect everybody trying to lift up, you know, the community. So what preamps do, in short, is they change sine waves to pulse waves. Okay, that's the long story short. So sine waves are it has a single frequency band. If we're looking at, you know, frequency chart, it will have like one linear line across. Now we go over this in our sound design courses at busyworksbeats.com. But for example, sine wave would have a linear harmonic structure as far as frequency, whereas a pulse wave would have multiple harmonics, and harmonics are multiples of the fundamental frequency. So for example, if I have a 3X OSC, and I just let me open up Wave Candy real quick. So we teach this again in our sound design course at busyworksbeats.com. So a sine wave, let's go back to 3X OSC. So this is a sine wave, the up and down curvy bell shaped looking thing. Now without all the background noise, you wouldn't see all these. Let me mute my mic. That's why you see all those other lines. So you can see how a sine wave is just this linear frequency. But if I change this sine wave to a square wave, look at how many harmonics we create. And harmonics are multiples of that frequency. So if the sine wave is playing at 60 hertz, all these little other lines are multiples of 60. So it's 60, 120, 180, 240, 300, 360, 420, 480, 540, and on and on and on, 600 and up. So those are called the harmonics. So what we're doing when we're using a preamp is turning the sine wave into a pulse wave. And it makes stuff sound louder because we have more higher frequency content. Remember, the ear picks up on frequencies from about 2K to 5K a lot easier. That's why they have a whole range from here, 2K to 5K, because that's where you're really sensitive to frequency. So stuff sounds louder simply by changing the waveform. It's the same exact dB level, but the pulse wave sounds louder, okay? So that's the secret behind the preamp. It can make stuff sound louder by changing the waveform textures into more harmonic stuff. So that's why it sounds louder. Okay, now let's do it. Okay, let's. Okay, so I'm keeping my kick basic, but now we're going to do. Now we went over this in our How to Make Your Drums Harder video. But we're gonna open up Fruity Soft Clipper and turn your post level down. This is just the output dB level. Okay, that's all this means. Now what I'm gonna do is go to the kick and the hidden, it's not called a preamp. And again, I wish people could understand, maybe if ImageLine decides to reformat things, they'll call it a preamp. But if you go to your wrench tool, there's something called the level adjustments volume multiplier. This is your preamp. So if I crank this up, it's gonna transform the sine wave based kick. You see how it's curvy? Into more of this square wave shape, that little, you know, blocky area. So it's mostly a sine wave with a couple areas of square tones to it. But now we're gonna turn it into a square wave for sure. So I'm gonna crank this volume multiplier. See how the kick feels more alive now? Now all we gotta do is just turn the post level down, or what you can do is now use the fader. So my point in doing this is that now we can get intensity out of the kick without having to crank the fader all the way up and use it a bunch of dB. We're still getting loudness out of the kick. And you can punch it even harder if you want it. Now there's a certain point where it starts to sound more plasticky, and that's usually the spot where you want to stop pushing it on the preamp. It depends on what you're trying to go for, but if I push this all the way, hear how it sounds boxy and less bassy? So there's like a sweet point in between. And that's how you get the body out of your kick without having to turn your kick up and make it the loudest thing as far as dB. So leveling is the secret behind, you know, mixing. Like for example, I could do the same exact thing with the soft clipper technique to the bells. So let's go to Omnisphere, go to your cog, go to your wrench tool, and go to volume multiplier. This is what makes a guitar distorted. Let me see if I can find a guitar. I think they have a guitar in here under instruments, guitar, and they used to have the samples in here. But let's go from Stratocaster. Okay, now that we have that opened up, I'm gonna run that through the same process again, the Fruity Soft Clipper. And we're gonna use the built-in volume multiplier under the cog wheel, the wrench tool, the volume multiplier, the preamp knob. I'm gonna show you how we turn regular guitar inputs, or DI guitar, direct input guitar, into distorted guitar. Now this kind of has a buzz to it, so let me find one that's a little cleaner. Maybe jazz guitar. So we're gonna take this smoother guitar and run it again, turn the preamp up, go to your wrench tool, volume multiplier, again, make sure you have the soft clipper on. And I'm gonna even turn the fader down, but crank the volume multiplier. So we're still getting a lot of loudness out of it, and it turns into a distorted signal. But look at the fader. We can pull it almost all the way down and it's still heard. So it shows you that dB does not necessarily mean loudness. Let's open up our bell. Okay, so let me just continue. We might as well finish out this idea. Let's go to busyworksbeats.com for the Ultimate Producer Bundle. Grab a snare. Let's find a snare that doesn't have much to it. Even a clap. Let me show you how to do it on a clap. Okay, let's put our clap on a 3 and 7 count. And I'm going to do the same exact technique. Now again, I learned this from Ron DiSilvestro because he's a master of drums. I mean, a crazy engineer over at Forge Recording Studios over in the outside of Philly. And the sound of his drums comes from using the preamp so well, and all his other recording techniques. So let me go to Fruity Soft Clipper. So when he showed me the recording process, I understood the importance of a preamp, because now it's taking that kind of bland boom and it's making it boom. You know, that's the difference. So let's run the clap through. Now this isn't the only way to make your drums hit. This is only one of the ways, and there are different preamps as well. That's why you'll see a lot of people use limiters on their sound so they can create that dynamic and understand that there's a contrast. So what I'm going to do is add a limiter. Now I know I'm going into deeper things, but what we're doing is chopping off the kind of unevenness of the left and right of the bell and making it a simple flat response. So look at how this is bouncing left and right. We're going to chop off the peaks so that it looks more like a flattened top. So now it's stopping at a certain amount, okay? That's where the limiter comes into play. So now I know for sure that this will stop at whatever dB, negative 23. And you can push it harder with the threshold if you wanted to. Basically make the bells louder, but still remain at that negative 23 position. This is why leveling is important. Let's add halftime since they mentioned halftime in the cable guys. I think it was halftime. Maybe they just said cable guy. So let's add a little flair to it. Again, I'm just trying to show you how to think when it comes to mixing. So for the guitar, let me add a CLA effects. And I like to turn my mix level down here because it gets loud. And I like the phaser preset. I think we can use a little more reverb. Okay, so you can push the clap, you can push the kick. So this is how you add the vibrancy to your mix. Again, we're not creating the greatest beat in the world. This is more so for demo sake, but hopefully you understand now the importance of volume multiplication. So your hi-hat does not need to be this loud. Look, I mean, as far as dB level, it doesn't need to be this high. Why is it all the way up at negative 8? Okay, so let's turn it down. Here's another thing about FL Studio I just remembered. FL Studio has a different leveling process. So if you open up Studio One in Ableton, well, let's just say Studio One, because I know that for sure. When you go into Studio One, your leveling's a lot different. Like the levels aren't all the way at the top. For example, this fader works a lot differently than Studio One, is my point. So your sounds are coming in way hotter in FL Studio. Whereas Studio One, they would probably pull this down. I don't know if they do it automatically or if their faders are just different. But you can audibly hear. Again, if you can hear the hi-hat, why do we need it to be negative 8? But you can always get the loudness out of it using that preamp technique. Okay, so let's go on to the 808. So let's grab an 808 from the Ultimate Producer Bundle. And I used to make the mistake, and I appreciate Young Guru for pointing that out. When I'm recording, my levels are pretty hot. So this is a negative 10, spot. So I would probably back up just a little bit so the mic isn't so hot in the recording process, or I would simply turn down my output of my my preamp, okay, to adjust that level so I could record, and be a lot louder without clipping. So again, another area where you could probably improve is your recording. Let's add an 808. Let's add 808 distort. And again, I'm creating the most basic beat here, but it's more for understanding levels. Let's look at our 808 level. Okay, now, again, our 808, now there's different, I can't get into everything about everything, but there's different aspects of an 808. There's a transient, which is this sharp point, and then there's the body. So you also have to remember you have a kick, so you don't necessarily need that sharp point of the 808 to have the 808 feel. So I'm not going to get into everything about transients and all this, but the point is, the only reason the volume peaks is because of that peak. So we can chop off the peak using a limiter or a compressor. I'm just going to use a limiter in this case just to keep it basic. and I'm going to set a ceiling so that anything that goes above that ceiling chops out. A lot of people are scared to compress their 808s, whereas the sound you're probably going for has a compressed bass. So I don't understand why people say they don't like to compress 808s. Now, again, I can see why they don't in certain cases, but if you know about the preamp, you'd probably think about it differently. Now, I'm not telling you what to do, but I'm just saying compression is not necessarily a bad thing. So let's add a compressor to the 808. Now, if you're going for that rock sound, you know, the rock sound is known for compressing the bass going through a distressor. So I don't want to confuse you by going into too many aspects about everything, but let's just make the attack zero so you can hear the decompression. And I'm just going to go hard on it so you can hear it. And now we're going to go back to the 808, go to the volume multiplier and turn up the preamp. So now we're getting more sizzle out of the 808 without it actually flying beyond that point. Now we're also doing a lot more to the 808, which is extending its, so to speak, using saturation, different things. This is how you can get that Ronnie J sound without, you know, going crazy with the leveling. And you can even pull down your 808, so there's contrast between the kick and the 808. Now even, okay, so there's so much to go over, but even Diego Ab talked about this. He says when he's on his master track, he doesn't go beyond 75%. So with FL Studio, it's not very evident because they kind of give you this vague coloring system, which is green, then it turns yellow. And yellow is right next to zero, so I don't know. There's really no in between of yellow and green. So what Diego would do in this case, let's consider zero the peak. Okay, so look at zero and then look at the floor. So somewhere in between zero and the floor would be 50%. So let's say negative 12 or negative 15 would be 50%. So 75% would be like negative 6 or negative 8. Now, I'm not giving you numbers to rely on. I'm just giving you a rough estimate. But again, this is the difference between FL Studio and other DAWs. FL Studio tends to come in super hot. There's still volume here. And again, we can make it louder. So the questions start to become, can you hear the sound? Does it need to be that high up in dB? That's now the process of thinking. Now that everything has its place, you have the kick is the loudest, clap is the loudest, then you have the 808 as the sub kick, so it's just below the kick, and then everything else. Now again, the reason we turn it down on the master is because you can compensate for that leveling using compression and limiters and all these things. I'm not going to complicate it though. Again, we have full mixing courses at busyworksbeats.com. Now here's, I don't know what it was. Actually, without the plugins, it would be clipping. But let me, to be safe, what I'm going to do is add a limiter, soft clipper. And pull it down just to be careful. Okay, now I'm going to do it without. Okay, so guard your ears, hide your kids, hide your wife. This is the same effect, but without all the precautions that we took into play. So now it's going to sound super, super muddy, and it's going to sound so intense that I'm going to pull down the master because I don't want to blow your ears out. Okay, so let me pull this down to be safe. But here's without all the stuff we did. This is just if you just slam the mixer. That doesn't sound pleasing at all. Now here's with all the precautions that we took into play. Now also, to be fair, to be fair, there was an effect on, there was a halftime effect. There's so many little things. There was a halftime effect on, so the stuff sounds a little bit different as far as like this, the melody and the guitar, but for the most part, you can hear the bass is super wobbly and it sounds terrible. And here it sounds more controlled. So again, let's do it without. players with. So when you create depth, now hopefully you understand the difference between the two, especially with that AB. It sounds like mud and garbage and amateurness, amateur night compared to a controlled thing. Now, once you understand how to control stuff more, as far as the dynamic and the leveling and all that, now you can think about stereo imaging and the next steps along the way. But also, your vocal has now, it has room to fit in this song. Whereas if you take off all the leveling adjustments we did, then it just sounds like your vocal has no space to sit in the mix. And that's where all the complications come from. So that's why you need to create like a gap in volume. So now our vocal can sit somewhere between the kick and the 808. You can almost visually see a pocket for the vocal. Same thing goes for your vocal recording. So hopefully you understand the importance of leveling and, you know, preamps. Again, it's really just a disconnect because FL Studio doesn't make it obvious what a preamp is. There's no real knob that says preamp. You know, that's why people don't understand the importance of a preamp or understand what it does. All right, so we'll keep it simple. If you want to learn more about mixing, go to BusyWorksBeats.com. We have premium music production training at BusyWorksBeats.com. You can click that link below to get started. We go over vocal mixing, how to level, how to master, mixing as a whole, sound design. We go over a lot of things at BusyWorksBeats.com. So thanks for watching today. It's BusyWorksBeats.com.